Hi, everyone, and thanks for having us here today. We're really excited to talk to everyone about the Safe Babies Court team. I see some familiar faces out there who may know just as much as Liz and I do because they've been involved for so long. So glad to have everyone here. Like she said, my name is Sarah Bilkey, and I'm the community coordinator for the Tulsa Safe Babies Court team. And my presentation that we tested, there we go. And I'm going to talk to you first about what the Safe Babies Court team is. Just for a little bit of historical context, Tulsa Safe Babies Court team got started in Tulsa County in July of 2015. At that time, we took our first pilot cases, which was just 20 cases in Judge Francine's courtroom, our former presiding judge for Tulsa County Juvenile Division. In March of 2018, that two and a half year pilot ended, and we really looked at some of the data and the impact that we had seen from Tulsa's Safe Babies Court team. And it was determined that the pilot had been successful and we'd seen some really good outcomes. And so in October of 2018, we doubled our size and expanded into a second docket in front of Judge Sparkman, who was the other judge presiding over deprived or child welfare cases here in Tulsa County. So since October of 2018, we've had 40 cases at any given time as one closes and new one opens in front of the two judges in Tulsa County that hear deprived cases. Judge Francine, our original judge, has since retired, and there's a new presiding judge at Tulsa County, Judge Martha Rupp Carter. And so we have now 20 cases in front of her. So just to give everyone an idea of which families the Safe Babies Court team works with, I think when a call goes into the hotline and there are concerns from the community about a child and their well-being, child welfare can identify them in kind of three different ways. One, a family in need of supportive community services. So that can be an in-home case or just referrals made without any kind of child welfare intervention. Then there's the family with children in foster care, which is the kiddos who are formally involved with the court. Then there are others who are just at risk, which would be more the intensive home-based services cases. Safe Babies Court teams works in between those two circles that are yellow and blue, which are the kiddos who are fully in foster care and also those children who are imminently at risk of being in foster care. All of our families are court involved. And the Safe Babies Court team has lots of objectives, but our primary objective and goal is to achieve timely and nurturing permanent placement for infants and toddlers in the court's jurisdiction. We know from lots of research that the infancy and early childhood time in a child's life is critical for brain development. It's important for speech, mental health, and all sorts of later outcomes. I don't know how many people are familiar with the ACE study. I think most people these days are, but we know that if we can prevent some of those traumas or adverse experiences happening in early childhood, it creates a healthier long-term life for kiddos. We also know that kids are resilient, and so if they have already experienced trauma early in life, we're able to put in place supports early on in those first 3 years, their ability to overcome those adverse childhood experiences, they have a much better chance of that. So the Safe Babies Court team really focuses on concurrent planning to make sure that they achieve timely permanency. We focus on using evidence-based practices in mental health and child development to make sure that those kids are catching up or overcoming the adversity they've faced. We try to minimize placement changes to prevent more trauma occurring, increase access to mental health services, early intervention services, and consistent health care. We also make sure that lots of post-permanency supports are in place for those families so that once they leave the court system, we're not just leaving them high and dry without any continued support. This is kind of an idea of what the court team looks like and what each family is getting as a part of the Tulsa Safe Babies court team. There's a judge involved in every case who's trained in infant mental health and safe babies court team practices. There's a community coordinator that serves my role. They have a child's attorney, of course, in every case, a parent's attorney. There's a DHS worker, sometimes more than one DHS worker, CASA volunteers and advocate managers. We have CPP therapists and other infant mental health trained therapists, healthcare providers, and those healthcare providers can be for developmental needs or physical health needs. And so that's just a glimpse of what a family's team looks like. At any given moment, there could be many more people also involved, but that most every case has that team surrounding them. And Liz is going to talk a little bit more about the 10 core components that make up the Safe Babies core team and what we have to have to maintain fidelity to the model.
Thank you, Sarah. So there are 10 core components to the 0-3 Safe Babies model. The first one is judicial and child welfare leadership, and that's local leadership, which establishes and champions a vision of equity, respect, and well-being for infants and their families. Our Safe Babies court team actually started way before we took on that first case, years before that, with Judge Francine and some other local child welfare advocates. And it has been moving forward ever since. So that was definitely the first component, is the judicial leadership is important to champion moving forward. The second core component is the local community coordinator. One of the things that we're extremely lucky with is that Sarah has been with us since the very beginning, before Safe Babies took its first case. So she has been a consistent present and keeping us on track for the fidelity of the Safe Babies model. She is a neutral party in the team, and she's positioned to facilitate. There's a lot of individuals at the table with very different objectives, roles, and kind of different ways of thinking. You have attorneys that are thinking about what's best for their client and advocating for their client, and you have therapists that's thinking about, you know, infant mental health. And so kind of Sarah or the community coordinator brings that all together and keeps our goal the same. The number three component is the active community stakeholders team. And so that's a group of stakeholders that meet once a month. They champion and engage in collaborative work that transforms systems and creates opportunities for infants, toddlers, and their families. They also look ahead and look at resource improvement. So some of the things that we've definitely discussed in our stakeholders meetings are where are there gaps? Do we have enough child, parent, psychotherapists to meet the need of the infants and toddlers coming into care? The fourth component is meeting the parents where they are, having that empathy for the parents. This is extremely important to have that empathy when you come to the table, to understand that the parents, they were once children too, and understand kind of where the parents are coming from. I think a lot of us, when we first come into this type of work, we look at kind of the two-dimensional aspect of child welfare. But when you really get into it and look at the parents and understanding where what brought them to the point that they're at and how much courage it takes to stand there and have those conversations. I think it's one of the best parts of Safe Babies, and it's definitely something that has spread out throughout the rest of the court teams. Concurrent planning and limiting placements. So we know with lots of research that children do best if they're not moved around a lot. They need that time to attach to their caregiver. So one of the core components that they look at is concurrent planning. So when a child comes into the system, the plan is for reunification, but they also look at, is there a potential for adoption? Would this placement be a potential adoptive placement? Just to make sure that if the parents' rights are terminated, that they end up in a placement and they don't have to continue to move around. So that way they don't have to start over from the very beginning. So in order to get permanency quicker, they enlist concurrent planning. So I think this is a big ask. The bridging is a wonderful piece of that, and I definitely have seen a lot of really beautiful things come from it. But we ask that the foster parents, it seems like a big ask, but it's actually not hard. I think once, you know, Safe Babies family team meetings get started and we're bringing foster parents in and parents in, the bridging naturally happens. So foster parents are able to bridge with the parents and help them with the relationship as they move forward with their kiddos. I've seen some beautiful things happen with this, where the foster parent continues after the case closes as a positive permanent person in the parent's lives. So that's definitely something that we strive to facilitate. Inclusion. So once a month, family team meetings where all the parties get together, including the foster parents and the parents, attorneys and therapists, healthcare providers, CASA, advocate managers with CASA, DHS workers, they all get together and they discuss barriers to permanency, how the kiddos are doing, how the parents are doing, what other resources the parents need in order to move the case forward. The connection, of course, in looking at attachment with babies, we want to maintain that connection with the parents when they're out of the home. So we promote frequent and quality family time to maintain and strengthen attachments between babies and their parents. We usually have a minimum of 3 visits per week in order to, and then, you know, more if it's at all possible. Well-being. So the continuum of parenting interventions, mental health and substance abuse prevention and treatment services. So one of the great things about Tulsa is that we have a lot of resources here. And so Safe Babies ensures the timely access of those resources so they get the quality services that they need while they are working hard to reunify with their kiddos. And reflection. So this has been an interesting component, because I've seen safe babies, while keeping with the fidelity of the model, using the reflection and analysis to continuously improve the quality of the program and make adjustments along the way. And I've seen that on the group level as Safe Babies Court Team, as well as the individuals in Safe Babies Court Team. So reflection is a big component to maintaining the fidelity of the model, but also making adjustments, course correcting along the way. And now Sarah's going to look at the Safe Babies impact.
Okay. There we go. So as Liz said, we have those 10 core components that come from 0 to 3. I think what I forgot to mention at the very beginning is the Safe Babies Support Team approach is a model that was developed by 0 to 3, a national nonprofit based out of Washington, D.C., that focuses on infant and toddler mental health and well-being. And so it's in the California evidence based research. It's in that database, as well as several other databases around the web that we can reference for evidence-based practices. So every 6 minutes in the US, an infant or toddler is removed from their parents' care due to abuse or neglect and sent to live in a new home or a foster home as we know them. Just to give some reference here, in Tulsa County, that number fluctuates from time to time, but right now is sitting around 540. So 540 infants and toddlers just in Tulsa County right now who have experienced abuse and neglect and been removed from their family. So when we look at these impacts and these outcomes from the Tulsa Safe Babies Court Team, just to put it in context, these are for 20 at first and then 40 families at a time out of that 540 total that are in the system. So one of the main indicators that we look at for the Tulsa Safe Babies Court Team is reoccurrence of maltreatment within a 12-month period. We look at that locally, but that's also something that's looked at on a national level with Safe Babies Court Teams and also just child welfare practice in general. And so you can see on that first line that for Tulsa, over the last 5 years since we've been operating, we've had 0%, so no children come back into child welfare custody after their case had closed. That's compared to 0.7% for all national Safe Babies Court Teams. And just to give some perspective, that number is growing pretty rapidly. But I would say when this information was pulled, that was probably about 40 sites across the country. Most states have one or two sites that they're developing right now, but there are a few states across the country that have gone statewide, like the entire state of Florida has a Safe Babies Court Team in each county. Tennessee is working on adapting to have Safe Babies Court Teams in each county as well. So that's the 0.7% number. And then the national number, which is 9.1%. So we see a significantly decreased rate of reoccurrence of maltreatment using the Safe Babies Court Team approach. Another one of the indicators that we really look at and try to impact in a positive way is the number of placement changes the child experiences. So for Tulsa Safe Babies Court Teams, that's 83% of our children have two or fewer placements within the span of their case. For Safe Babies Court Teams nationally, that number is 79.4%, and the national number is 66.1%. I think anyone who works in child welfare knows how hard that number is to achieve and how hard it is to limit placement changes because there are so many factors that come into play when you're looking at placements, like making sure that we can get a child placed in a relative placement or a kinship placement quickly as their first placement. And also complying with all of the Indian Child Welfare Act standards when it comes to Indian children. So these are some more impacts and outcomes that we look for as a court team. One is permanency reached within 1 year. So for all SBCT sites across the country, that number is 83.7% of children reached permanency within a year, compared to 40.5% across the country, which is a significant difference. Drilling that down more to just Tulsa County, the average length of time in foster care for our Safe Babies Court Team case is 15 months. That's from date of removal to the date the case is closed in the court, whether that's reunification or adoption. For Tulsa County, that number is 20 months. So children participating in the Safe Babies Court Team in Tulsa County are exiting the system about 5 months faster. One of the reasons we look at length of time to permanency is because of the developmental stage that the infant or toddler is in and all of the bonding and attachment that's happening in that time frame. A lot of the kiddos that we work with come into care at birth or in very early infancy. We see a large number of substance exposed newborns. And so when you think about them being in care for 15 months, that's the entirety of their life. And so they've spent all of that time in a foster home, most often attaching and bonding to that caregiver. And we know that the longer they spend in that foster home, the harder it is to be moved later on and the more impact that's going to have on their ability to attach and bond in the future. We also try very hard to avoid a period of forced attachment right around the 18-month mark that can make it even more traumatizing to the child to be moved at that time.
Hey, Sarah.
Three of those accomplishments for 2019. To date, we had served, this was at the end of our fiscal year. So to date in 2019, we had served 112 children since the beginning of the pilot from 90 families. And again, our average length of time in foster care was 15 months compared to Tulsa County DHS 20 months. And our reoccurrence of maltreatment was 0%. So that takes us to current time. And you saw this timeline earlier when we got started. So moving into the end of 2020 and the beginning of 2021, our court team has decided that we'd very much like to have all infant and toddler cases treated as a Safe Babies Court Team. We've seen the positive impacts that the approach has, and we very much would like it to not be a pilot anymore or a specialty court. So the judge Judge Carter specifically tasked us with finding a way to push these outcomes out and these positive impacts out to all children, infants and toddlers specifically. As she was kind of applying that pressure and encouraging us to do that, we had some research come out from the American Institute for Research that really helped us along in that strategic planning. So AIR is based out of Washington, D.C., and they do a lot of social science research on early childhood, education, poverty, things of that nature. So they came to Tulsa and studied the Safe Babies Court Team approach. They studied it here in Tulsa, also in Des Moines, Iowa, and Little Rock, Arkansas. And what they did was they looked at three specific groups. They studied the full SBCT cases. They studied the cases that were being heard in a judge's courtroom that was implementing SBCT, the traditional cases, so the non-SBCT cases in front of that judge. And then they compared that with what they called the control judge, which was another judge in that same county who was randomly assigned cases that had no SBCT training or court team operating underneath them. So for Tulsa, they looked at our cases with Judge Francine and compared them to the cases in Judge Sparkman's courtroom prior to him becoming an SBCT judge. And what they found was that the cases in front of the SBCT judge, both full SBCT and just traditional cases in front of that judge, were achieving permanency more quickly than the control judge. But they didn't find a hugely different change between full SBCT cases and the traditional cases in that trained judge's courtroom, which was really exciting to everyone at 0 to 3 and who was doing Safe Babies court team approaches across the country, because we've all been hoping and striving for systemic change all along, but this was the first time that we had research that showed that by treating 20 cases in this specialty way, almost as like a training lab, we were actually seeing spillover of the impact into all of the other cases within that judge's courtroom, which allows you to achieve the same impact for those cases with far fewer resources and at far less of a cost than you would otherwise be able to achieve. So we were really excited about that outcome. They also looked at reoccurrence of abuse and neglect. And what they found in that was that that the cases in front of the SBCT trained judge had fewer reoccurrences of abuse and neglect than the control judge, and that the full SBCT cases had an even smaller frequency of reoccurrence of abuse and neglect. So we did see more of an impact for full SBCT cases when it came to that indicator. But for those of you who are probably more statistically trained than I am, that difference was not considered statistically significant. We also looked at long-term child well-being after participating in a Safe Babies court team, which involved calling all of the former Safe Babies families who had completed their court case, and also calling a random sampling of traditional child welfare cases and doing caregiver interviews on the child's well-being post-discharge from the court. And what they found in that instance was that children and caregivers who had exited the Safe Babies court team approach, court team had reported higher instances of success in long-term child well-being outcomes like development, physical health, and emotional health. They also reported feeling more confident in their skills than the control families did. So we took that information and that research and used that in our planning for the future for Safe Babies court teams, and created basically two different levels of intervention. So at the courthouse, there continue to be at this time two judges who are handling all of the deprived cases for Tulsa County. And so our goal moving forward is going to be to have 20 what we're calling SBCT training lab cases under each one of those judges. And then we're going to take a more focused approach in monitoring and collecting data on what we're calling the SBCT impacted cases, which are all of the other cases that are being heard in front of that judge. We're also focusing on a lot of training, cross-discipline training about the Safe Babies court team approach, but also about early childhood education, infant mental health, and all of the different subject areas that apply to kiddos and child welfare custody to help cross-train all of the professionals at the courthouse, not just those who are directly working with the Safe Babies court team. So that's our plan for moving forward. And that's all we had. We finished a little early. Does anyone have any questions?
Thank you, Sarah and Elizabeth. We will give you all a few seconds to see if you have any questions.
Currently privately funded by about 6 different local charitable organizations. There is talk at a national level. 0 to 3 just received quite a bit of money from a federal grant to expand the practice. So there's talk of applying for some of that money to expand here at a state level in Oklahoma, not just for Tulsa County. There's also there are some pay for success opportunities that different state agencies have looked at as a possible opportunity for funding, perhaps through the state.
If you can just share with the audience a little bit, how was it? I mean, I know we talked about it before we started this session, but if you can just describe a little bit, how was the COVID-19 during this time with the kiddos? How were you able to keep in touch with the babies, especially with babies that you are not able to do Zoom with them and things like this? So if you can just take just a few minutes and just share with us how it worked, I think it would be great.
Sure.
Liz, and there is also one question after Christina will read it.
Yeah, Liz, if you'll share how it was for CASA, I'll put our email addresses in the chat and then I can speak for how it was as a court.
Okay. So CASA has continued to visit kids virtually. It's been a little bit difficult for the infants and toddlers. So keeping up the communication with the foster parents, checking in on the parents has been, you know, biweekly has been what we've been doing. Having FaceTime so we can see how the kiddos are doing. One of the great things about Safe Babies in particular is the closeness that the team has. So the foster parents and the CASAs are pretty close. The natural parents and the CASAs are very close. So they're able to really continue that those communications.
Yeah, and I would say for the court team, because we don't do weekly or monthly visits with the families, that's the different service providers that are part of the team who do that. But we were able to maintain our family team meetings from the start. We just shifted very early to using Zoom and had great success in getting parents and foster parents to join us in that way. We even had some of our babies on Zoom, so we had everybody there with us virtually. And the court has since been able to do some adapting and is now working in a limited capacity to hear some cases. So our cases are typically heard once a month at the courthouse, as opposed to a traditional case that might only be heard once every 6 months. So it definitely impacted us pretty significantly, but we've been able to utilize BlueJeans and email paper review hearings to try to keep up some contact between our judges and our cases as we move forward.
Thank you. And there is a comment. Christina, would you read it, please? And also, I just want to let you know that Christina wrote you both emails in the chat already.
Okay, so the comment in the chat says, my personal SGCT kiddo loves to take the phone and gets to have special FaceTiming with me, and I'm finding she's actually maintaining some of her normal visits rituals via FaceTime.
Yeah, and that came from one of the CASA advocates assigned to several safe babies cases. I was trying to think how many she had, but quite a few. And we found that, of course, some kids, you know, especially the babies, the true, like, infant babies, don't really know what's happening with the FaceTime consciously. But those toddlers love the phone, and they like to kind of have it right there and grab it and do whatever they want. So it's been successful. We've worked really hard to help educate and encourage our parents that even though they're 6 week old isn't giving them any kind of verbal cues that they're enjoying that FaceTime, that it's so important to keep letting that child hear their voice and just have that contact with them. And so our infant mental health therapist and the whole court team has really worked to keep reminding parents of that 5 minutes spent reading a book every night to their 6 week old is time well spent and will serve with helping that bond continue while this is going on. But all of our families have been incredibly excited and grateful for some limited face-to-face visits to be starting again.
Okay, thank you. So it looks like it's time to say goodbye, unless someone else would like to open the mic. And to thank you both ladies for this time that you share with us and this important knowledge. And thank you. A big thank you.
Thank you.